So this video will go over lab 6, which is on osmosis and dialysis. So the objectives of this lab is to learn how to prepare a solution from a solid or by dilution, which are the two main ways that we prepare solutions. We will study the effects of different solution concentrations on cells and learn the differences between dialysis and osmosis. So let's review what is osmosis. And so osmosis is the spontaneous net movement of solvent molecules through a semi-permeable membrane from a region of low solute concentration to a region of higher solute concentration. And so the solvent will try to equalize the concentration on both sides of the membrane by moving into the side where it's more concentrated in solutes. And so the reason why it's the solvent who moves, it's because the semi-permeable membrane doesn't allow the solute to move through it. So only the solvent can move through the semi-permeable membrane. And so the solvent will try to equalize the different concentrations on both sides of the membrane. And so osmolarity is something we need to use to compare the concentrations of the solutions. So osmolarity is essentially the same as molarity, except that it accounts for the concentration of all solute particles, keeping in mind that some solute particles are dissociating when they dissolve. So you have to pay attention to the formula of your solute, and if it's an ionic compound, for example, like KNO3, and if you have a 1 molar KNO3 solution, because KNO3 will dissolve into dissociate into K plus and NO3 minus, two particles per formula, then you will need to multiply the molarity by 2, and the osmolarity will be 2 osmolarity per liter, even though the molarity is 1. But because you have two particles per formula, then the osmolarity is 2. And so that's what is more important when you are dealing with osmosis, because that means there is more solute particles per unit of volume in the case of KNO3 than, for example, a molecule like the amino acid glycine, because when glycine is not dissociate, it stays as one big molecule. And so when you have a 1 molar solution of glycine, it's also a 1 osmolar solution of glycine. So the molarity equals the osmolarity in this case because it's 1 particle per formula. So then if you had these two solutions between, separated by a semi-permeable membrane, then the 1 molar KNO3 would be considered more concentrated from the point of view of osmolarity. Another thing that is important to understand is that it's the number of particles that matters most. It's not the identity of the particles. They don't matter. It's really the number of particles that matters for osmosis and any colligative property. And so that's why the fluids we have in our bodies can be compared to other solutions with different kind of solute, but the concentration matter here. And so solutions that are isotonic to the body, isotonic means it's the same osmolarity, are 0.92% mass per volume or 0.15 molar solution of NaCl. These are designated to be isotonic with the cytosol, which is the intracellular fluid. And so dialysis is different from osmosis, is that It's the spontaneous net movement of solute molecules through the semi-permeable membrane. In dialysis, you have a membrane that allows the solute to go through. And it tries to simulate, like dialysis tubing, tries to simulate what the kidneys are doing in our bodies by filtrating, waste and small molecules. But because small molecules are allowed to go through, then the kidneys, there is a process for returning what's good in the body, in the blood, and then keeping what's waste and toxic and what you want to filter out. So when we are dealing with dialysis, we need to know the size of the pores of the dialysis tubing that we will use. And here we will be using a dialysis tubing that allows molecules with a molecular weight of up to 1200 grams per mole. These molecules can still pass through, and then the others above that will not be able to go through. Only smaller molecules than that can go through. So we will use the dialysis tubing as a simulation for our semi-permeable membrane. And we will use the potassium chloride as the solution that imitates the cytosol, and we will make it isotonic to body fluids. Okay, so the lab background information also goes through the dilution formula, M1V1 equals M2V2, which is the formula that you can use to find out one of the variable when you know the other three. So typically there's one you don't know and you want to find that value knowing the other three variables. And here the ones indicate the concentration and volume of, so M is for molarity, so concentration in molarity and volume of the stock solution, which is the concentrated solution. And the two here symbolize the concentration and the volume of the diluted solution. So you will need to go through the videos one at a time. And so the playlist is provided here, first link, but you can also just use the link for each video when it is time to watch that video. So the first part of the lab is about preparing solutions, and the first way to prepare it will be by dissolving a solid in water to form a solution. And then the second part, or it's still in the first part of the lab, but this second table here will be about the dilution of that first solution. So you need to watch the video and you will extract the observations from the video, namely the mass of NaCl measured. So report everything that you see on the screen of the balance. When we use digital scales, you report everything that the scales show you, and it does the estimating for you. So the last digit to the right is the estimated digit, but all digits are significant. Then from grams, you can find out the number of moles of NaCl, and for this we use the molar mass, right? So you will need to find out the molar mass of NaCl, and you can write it down on the side of the paper here. To the right of the table, there's a room. You could calculate your molar mass there. Then you will observe the volume of the solution. And so the professor is using a beaker. Beakers are not precise volume measurements. They are not calibrated to be precise. So when you read a beaker that has a line every 25 milliliters, that means, so that's the instrumental smaller division has a value of 25 milliliters and you divide by 10. So 25 divided by 10 is 2.5. So you have a precision of 2 to 3 milliliters when you read that kind of beaker. So you cannot give a precision to more than to the one place. And even, say it's 201 would be kind of almost too precise, right? Keep this in mind when you read the volume. Then it's asking you to change the milliliters into liters, and you can show your work on the right side of the table there and calculate the concentration in molarity of the solution. So molarity is the number of moles of solute, and so it's moles of NaCl, the second line of the table here, divided by the liters of solution, so divided by the volume of the solution in liters. And so pay attention to significant figures, and it would be nice to have all the units, given for each value. Then question one is asking you to compare this concentration you just calculated in the last line of the table 1A to the cell that will be filled with 0.15 molar NaCl. So 0.15 molar NaCl is a solution that is isotonic to body fluids. It simulates a real, cell, biological cell. And it's so you need to compare the concentration of the solution you just prepared to this concentration of 0.15 molar NaCl. And because your solute is the same, NaCl, right? The solute is the same. So here you don't really need to calculate the osmolarity because you have the same type of substance in the solution. So comparing the molarities will be enough to decide if you have a isotonic, hypotonic or hypertonic solution compared to that 0.15 molar NaCl. So as a reminder, isotonic means it's the same concentration, same number of particles per volume of solution. Hypotonic, it's when it's less, you have less particles per units of volume, so less concentrated. And hypertonic, it's when your solution is more concentrated than the 0.15 molar NaCl solution. So use that to explain your reasoning for choosing, one of those three adjectives here. Then you will watch the second video that shows how to prepare a solution by diluting the concentrated solution you found or you prepared in the first part. So we will use the concentration. So here you need to repeat the value you had from table 1A. So the first line of that table 1B here is going to be the same value as the last line of the table 1A there. So you copy that value here. It's the concentration of your initial NaCl solution. That's your concentrated or stock solution. Then in the video, the professor is withdrawing with a syringe two times a volume. And add this up to find the volume of the initial NaCl solution, right? It's a total volume from, picking the volume with a syringe two times. So that's going to be in milliliters. And the syringe, I think, can be read. Watch the lines to know how precisely you can read that. Once you have your volume in milliliters, you can change that to liters. And then that's the small volume of the concentrated solution. So you take out a small volume of the concentrated solution, put it in another beaker, and then you fill with water up to a final a volume. And so that's what this total volume of final solution is about. So you want to write down the volume once the water has been added to the small amount of concentrated solution, change that into liters, and then calculate the molarity of the final solution. And for this, you will use the dilution formula that says M1V1 equals M2V2, right? And the final solution is your M2. So you're looking for M2 here. So again, you can show your work on the right side of the table here. So once you have the calculated concentration of the diluted solution, you want to compare it to, again, the same 0.15 molar NaCl solution. And here, it's still the same solute, still NaCl is the solute. So you want to compare that, compare just the molarities, because that will be enough to compare which one is more concentrated than the other. And again, decide from that if your final solution in table 1B here is isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic with the 0.15 molar NaCl solution that simulates body fluids here. And again, use the fact that, the comparison of the concentrations to explain your reasoning. So the second part of the lab is osmosis in simulated cells. So we will use dialysis tubing to simulate a semi-permeable membrane, and we will create cells by making a knot. It's a tubing, so you make two knots to make a cell. And the cells will be created and filled with 0.15 molar NaCl solution that is about isotonic with intracellular fluids, right, that we find in biological cells. The mass of the cells will be observed before and after the cell is placed in solution. And then you will calculate the difference in mass and then identify from that if you have an isotonic solution, hypotonic solution, or hypertonic solution with the simulated cell. So you have those videos to watch before you can fill in that table 2. So first, table 2 will require that you write down what is the solution in beaker A. And so we need a name and a concentration when it's appropriate. So for example, with water, there will be no concentration, but for beaker C, D, B, C, and D, you should have a concentration and then the name of the solute that is in the aqueous solution. So you need to write that down. Record the initial mass, the final mass of the bags. So make sure you put the values in the correct place. And so the first video will show you the initial mass for beaker A, B, C, D. And then the second video will show you the final mass for beakers A, B, C, D. And then you will need to calculate the change in mass by doing the final mass minus the initial mass in that order, such that if you have a negative value, it is correct. You need to put down the negative sign and write the value. So it can be positive or negative. And so this is important because that will determine if you have an isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic solution to the solution that was in the cells, right? So, and so here in question 3, it reminds you to write down what is the concentration of the solution inside the cell. So write that down here. How much time passed between the initial and final mass measurement? So in minutes. And so how do you decide if you have a isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic solution? Again, you compare the concentration, not again here, it's actually a different way to do it. You will need to take into account if the change in mass is positive or negative or zero. So If you have no change in mass, it means the water did not move more in or out of the bag, you know, because it's always moving in and out. But if you have no change in mass, that means water did not move more out or in. And then that means the concentrations of the two solutions inside the cell and outside in the beaker are isotonic, same concentrations. So then you would classify that as an isotonic solution. Note that it's very hard to have a zero change. There is some error, and you can have a small value even when a solution is actually isotonic. If your change of mass is a positive value, so that means your final mass was larger than your initial mass. So that means you gained mass. You gained in mass. The cell gained mass. And that means the water moved into the cell from the beaker solution inside the cell. And water does that by osmosis if it's more concentrated inside the cell. So that means the solution in the beaker is less concentrated. And then you would classify such a solution as hypotonic, because here you're classifying the solutions in the beaker, right? So the solution in the beaker would be hypotonic to the solution in the cell, because water moved into the cell to try to, you know, equalize the concentration. And then if you have a negative change in mass, if it's negative, that means your initial value was larger than the final value. And that means you lost mass. The cell lost water. The water moved out of the cell from inside the cell to the solution in the beaker. So water moved out of the cell, and that water goes from low solute concentration to high solute concentration. So that tells you the concentration of the solution in the beaker was higher than the concentration inside the cells. And so that tells you the solution of the beaker is hypertonic to the solution inside the cell. So a negative change in mass would indicate an hypertonic solution. So question four, you want to calculate the osmolarities for solutions that are in beaker B, C, and D. Osmolarity, as a reminder, we saw in the introduction that the osmolarity is equal to the molarity of the solution times the number of solute particles in that solution. So for example, if you have, let's look at the example of the 0.15 molar KCl solution, for example. We know that KCl is ionic, and when it's placed in water, it dissociates into K plus and Cl minus, right? The K plus potassium, which is in group 1A, so makes a positive one ion. And then the chloride ion, which is the Cl minus with one negative charge. So you, when you have KCl, you actually have two solute particles dissolved in solution. And so you multiply the molarity of 0.15 molar times two particles. And that will be an osmolarity of 0.30. Osmolarity, O-S-M-O-L. Slash liter, per liter. It's also per liter, right? And so that was the example of the 0.15 molar KCl, but you want to do that for your solutions of beaker B, C, and D. And then compare that to the intracellular fluid and decide if the molarities or the osmolarities better support your conclusions of, you know, is my solution isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic according to the change in mass. And you will see that one supports the results better than the other. So you want to tell that which one supports better, the molarities or the osmolarities. And if you want to draw things, you can insert a picture here. So question five is asking you to go back to that question two. Question two, that was this. It was about the diluted solution here, and you decided if it was isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic to the 0.15 molar NaCl. Whatever you decided here, you will need to reevaluate and see if your beaker B, the solution diluted in part 1A, table B of the lab, was used in beaker B. So it's actually your beaker B is the zero, the diluted NaCl solution. So is your prediction, because you predicted that it would be isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic, is your prediction matching the observed of experimental results here? So in the table here, did you say that the same thing? Was it the same isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic here in the table or not? And if it is not, then suggest an experimental source of error. So part three is a different part, really. It's not using the first videos, it's completely separate. You have a video here to watch. It's longer because there are more explanations on what's going on in this experiment. So this is more testing dialysis. Again, you will use a semi-permeable membrane that is simulated by dialysis tubing. There is a little bag made with glucose and starch in there. So you will need to write down the observations of your of the initial appearance of the solution inside the bag first, and then the solution in the beaker. So you want to write down your observations before anything is done to them, before the bag is placed into the beaker solution. So what does it look like inside the dialysis tubing, and what the solution in the beaker looks like? Then the appearance after 30 seconds is given by this picture here to the right. This picture is for the two lines in the middle here. You can see some blue streaks in the dialysis bag. It's not transparent, it's translucent, but there is some blue coloring appearing here. And then appearance of the solution in the beaker. And then appearance of the two solutions after 10 minutes. You need to watch the video for that. And again, tell what has changed in the appearance. And so the professor who's doing the video explains how you can know if, for example, glucose moved in or out of the bag, because at first glucose is in the bag only, in the cell. So did we detect it in the solution of the beaker at the end or not? So this is a good question to have, because it will help you answer question six. Based on your observations in part four, which of the following molecule can diffuse across the dialysis tubing? And, for example, glucose, you want to see if it was found in the beaker solution afterwards or not, because initially it was supposed to be only in the bag. And the starch, did it move out of the bag, because again, it was also inside the bag only at first. Iodine was in the solution, the brown solution. And so did it move inside the bag? Do we have a way to know this? If we do, and we saw it happening, then that means iodine moved also from the solution into the bag. So you want to circle those two, the molecules that can diffuse across the dialysis tubing. And then out of the molecules you've selected in question six, you want to decide if in a real cell membrane, in a real cell, having a real semi-permeable membrane of phospholipid bilayer, would those molecules be able to cross those membranes, the biological phospholipid bilayer, or not? So for this, you may need to get help from biology. So I want to say one more thing about the solutions you will see in the experiment here for table two. One of the formula, one of the ionic formula, is made of two metals, the alum. The name is given by the professor there. And so it gives the formula. And I want to be you to be aware that you have it's an ionic compound, but it's made of two different metals bonded to one anion, one type of anion. So be aware of that. So that means you will have two cations from that formula and one anion. But the number of particles, pay attention to subscripts, if you have more than one of each, to count the number of solute particles. But just be aware that there are two metals in one formula. It's still an ionic compound. In this course, we study simpler things, but in reality, sometimes you can have two different metals in the same ionic compound.